No one could ever have been quite prepared for the phenomenon of Jose Mourinho.
He is a big character, he's very confident.
He's a jewel in the crown, you know.
Far too good looking to stand next to me.
I think he's been a breath of fresh air to the Premier League.
He has brought magic.
He's probably the only man I would leave my husband for. And he's probably the only man that my husband would leave me for.
Something that this country maybe hasn't seen so much of.
Almost a year ago today, Jose Mourinho was hired by Chelsea owner Roman Abramovich to win the medals to justify the millions. The image of Mourinho is one of an ambitious, cunning, and at times arrogant man who would stop at nothing in his drive for success. But what's he really like behind that suave exterior? I've come to Chelsea to try and find out.
Chelsea have confirmed tonight the departure of manager Claudio Ranieri.
Porto's European Cup winning coach Jose Mourinho is the overwhelming favourite.
Mourinho is understood to be in a Porto tonight and is planning to fly into London tomorrow.
Jose Mourinho took his first steps in Premiership management today and immediately started working.
I'm European champion, so I'm not one of the bottle. I think I'm a special one.
How did the Chelsea move come about? What first attracted you to the club owned by the billionaire Abramovich?
In my hands, Chelsea and a big Italian club. And the next day of Champions League final.
Can I ask you which one?
They have a manager now. Okay. I think it's
you
not.
You don't have to answer.
Yeah, it's not difficult. They change manager every season.
Okay, I know.
So I had to think. And I met Peter Kenyon, Gene Tenenbaum and Roman in Monaco. And I like very much what they told me. The prospect of the future, very objective. Chelsea is not the best club in the world. Chelsea won not a premiership for 50 years. We want to win, we want to repeat, we want to create conditions for the club to be best club in country, best club in the world, big ambitions, and do you want to be part of it? And because it was the first meeting I had, and because I like so much the way they approached me and they proposed me a future with Chelsea, I told to George Mendes, forget, I want to join them.
Mourinho crashed into this country like some sort of foreign asteroid.
I'm always confident we have a top manager.
He does enjoy being an actor in the drama.
I'm never nervous. I'm an angel.
He had something about him where you thought immediately tabloids are going to love this guy.
I arrive here with my ego.
He's amusing, he's charismatic, you know, he cracks good jokes.
He kind of sort of oozes power.
You don't know me, you know me from half an hour every week. I'm not interested in myself, in my image, in what people think about me. You want that, not me. No faces that I say, I don't like that face, or I don't speak to this paper or to this television.
I think the press have fallen in love with Jose Mourinho because he gives as good as he gets.
The press doesn't love me so much. But
forgive me if this isn't just not very British.
Do you think you're misunderstood?
But I think I'm guilty. I think I'm guilty of that, so I cannot.
Yeah, because people say,
complain.
Well, he's very confident. Or he's arrogant, the same sort of thing that they would say.
Yes, very confident I am. Arrogant I don't think I am. No. But sometimes I feel I need to be like that because I think sometimes I need to play a little bit with emotions. I can be speaking with you, but I know that my players are watching. Players from other teams are also watching, and sometimes
so
we
it's
can.
It's a bit of an act.
Yes, it's a bit of an act.
I know him very well, and maybe he gives the impression that he's a little bit arrogant. But if you talk to the players and what I heard from the Dutch players like Robin in Chelsea, he's not an arrogant person. He looks like, but he's come from Portugal, and they have a little bit the South of Europe mentality and more emotion.
When you are in a press conference before a game, after a game, you know, before a game, the game starts there. Mm-hmm. And after the game didn't finish yet. Finished only with the press conference.
There are games within a game.
Yes, so I think you have to act a little bit and to show sometimes a different face. And I think I'm not bad with it.
I think most people in this country wonder what it would be like to work for Roman Abramovich. Does he interfere? Does he want to know what's going on?
Yes, he wants to know. Mm. But I told him in the beginning, because one of the funny things was when they met me, they were saying, not Mr. Abramovich, but Peter and Eugene, they were saying to me, we are a little bit afraid of your personality, you know? And I was saying to them, but afraid why? Afraid why? I'm Mr. Abramovich, your personality, his personality. And I thought, what he wants? Win? I want to win.
In Jose Mourinho, he's finally found a kindred spirit. Very different man, a very quiet billionaire Russian owner, takes on this hurricane from Portugal. But you can't deny that Mourinho is a winner.
You speak a number of languages. How's your Russian?
My Russian is about the dirty words, just about that. But I can understand the emotion. I don't understand the language, yeah. But I understand the emotion. And before the translation, I think I can...
Work it out.
Yes, I can work it out.
Does he understand football?
He understands football, he loves football, he reads football. You know, he's a person to be in a weekend and to see me on Monday and to tell me, did you see Barcelona-Sevilla? Yes. Did you see Lyon-Monaco? Yes. Did you see Roma-Inter? Yes. And I think, what you did in the weekend? You know, he eats football.
Jose's philosophy is to win, and I think he knows what nice football is, but he'll win anyway, he'll win ugly.
He gets his point across very well, and the players, when we go out to play on a Saturday, we know exactly what we have to do. That's everyone, from the goalkeeper to the strikers. We know exactly what we have to do, and we know how to do it, and I think that's been the main reason we've been so successful.
In terms of the way you like football to be played, and what was necessary to bring success, what would you describe as your style? Some people say Chelsea are a bit more defensive than the others. Or...
No. I think Chelsea went through phases. And the first phase was to give them tactical discipline. You cannot play just emotional, and I can understand English mentality is a little bit about that. And I want to show that I don't want to lose matches. I want to get the maximum points in the beginning, and I want to show that it's not easy to beat Chelsea, it's not easy to score against them. Step by step, the team was getting strong by the tactical point of view, but strong mentally, mm. Very strong. They were feeling the power. We score one goal, we don't lose. We can go away at home, don't concede goals. Clean sheet after clean sheet. After four or five matches, boring Chelsea, they don't score goals, they don't play football, the football is a disaster. And I was feeling, what is this, where I am, you know? I just arrived. But I got that in the good way. I was saying to the players every time, they don't like us because we win. Your team 1 year ago, 2 years ago, they love your team, but you won nothing. Now they hate us, but we won matches. So we are okay. And was important to close the dressing room door and to say what is outside, what they say about us, doesn't matter. The criticism, I think, was good.
It got to
you
a bit, though,
didn't
it?
Strong group, yeah.
It got to you. You didn't like it, did you?
No. I didn't like, because I think at that time, one of the reasons why I came to England was also because people in this country understand a football team is a process, and they give you the time. They don't give you...
Not at all clubs.
Yes, but normally, yes. Yeah. But you go to Latin countries, You don't get results after two months and you are out, you have no time to work. And I thought, I will have time for that.
So you didn't like the criticism, but you sort of understood it.
No, I understood that we must go to another level. But I was waiting for Robin. I was waiting for Duff. I was waiting for the improvement of Joe Cole. And I was waiting, but getting points. And when the players were back, the main question was both at the same time or one each time, Robin and Duff.
Mm. But you changed your system for that, didn't you?
We changed because of that, because they were so good.
Chelsea! Arjen Robin!
You've pitted your wits against two others that have played similar games over the years, usually against each other, Arsene Wenger and Alex Ferguson. Mm-hmm. It's nice to have a third member of that team.
Do they want to change their position with mine? Top of the league with 9 points. They cannot speak about blips because they are not in a better situation than us.
Do you see a psychological war between you and the other managers?
I tell you, you can ask to Sir Alex. I have a lot of respect. I call him boss because he's our boss. So no problems, no wars, no mind games. When we go to Man United, I will bring a very good bottle of wine because the wine we drank was very bad.
These two are very similar in that they're mind game players. They're intensely competitive.
You seem to get on better with Sir Alex than you do Arsene. Would that be true?
I like him very much. I like him. I think he's the person to have a fight with you, a words fight, or it never happens. It happens once with Porto, a little fight during the game. But he's the person that the game hands, everything hands. Come to my room. I go to your room, share a glass of wine, and we speak open. And I think he's a very correct person. And
Arsene Wenger, it seems a little bit different. There's a bit more sort of a bit of spite there.
I'm not worried with that, you know. I'm not worried with that. But for example, when he says he liked much more other Chelsea teams than our team, I know why.
Why?
Because we are champions. I have to be fair. I didn't like Arsenal in the beginning of the season, where they smash everybody. I don't like them now, where they beat Everton 7-0 and they have...
Why don't you like that?
Because they win.
Oh, okay.
I like them very much in the middle of the season. Every weekend, they lose points. I was in love with them. You know, every week, Chelsea wins, they get a draw. 5. Next week, they lose. 8. Next week, they lose. 10. 11. I was in love with them, so I understand why you don't like us.
He's done some very smart things. And the best thing he did was the first thing he did when he got to Chelsea. He got rid of 10 players. Because nothing can be worse for a coach than having too many players around the place. Better to have too few. And that's what he left himself with. He left himself with quite a lean squad.
I think the club have been very, very clever and they brought young, hungry players who are ready to fight for each other, who don't want to be the hero and don't want to be, you know, the main man or anything. All we want to do is play for each other and win games for Chelsea.
The boys all think he really knows his business as well, if not better, than any other manager they've encountered. And so their commitment to what he creates and designs for the manner and the form of play and the tactics and so on, they absolutely accept as it. And what he wants, they will try and give him. The result is, of course, we have a phenomenal team this year.
I think that winning the championship might have surprised him. I don't think he was sure he could win it in the first season. I think by Christmas, all doubts had, in his mind, as in all of ours, had disappeared.
When did you think it was your title?
I thought in many occasions.
August.
Something happened after that. Something happened after that where you think it's not over. But... One period is when a moment I never forget was we beat Tottenham away. We jumped from 5-8. And Arsenal played 2 hours later in Bolton. So we come in the bus with 8 points. And I was thinking, this can go from 8 to 7. A draw is good. They lost. So our buzz was a circus for the first time.
They won the 1-0 at Tottenham when we lost at Bolton, just 1-0. You transform that hope into belief and then conviction that you will really make it. And then you just take off. And they got that.
Everybody jumping and screaming, 8 points, pa pa pa. And that moment was a moment where I thought, ooh, 8 points. 8 points, you can make a mistake, you can control the emotion. They will lose also a few points. Was a moment where I felt it's very, very difficult to lose the championship.
Lampard, it's 2-0, it's Chelsea's championship.
Jose Mourinho grew up a long way from the King's Road lifestyle he lives now. He was born 42 years ago in the fishing town of Setúbal, south of Lisbon. The son of a professional footballer, the game was always in his blood.
Well, about 35 years ago, Jose was 5, 6, 7 years old, and his father was the goalkeeper from Vitória. And in the trainings, his father was there defending, and Jose was in the back of the goal, and all the balls that go out, Jose will get them and bring it to the pitch again. So some part of his youth as a child was passed here in this, seeing the trainings of his father.
Your father was a goalkeeper.
Yes.
Felix was his name. And yes. He was quite good, wasn't he? He played for the international.
Yes, it was. He played all his career in the Premiership, in the Portuguese Premiership.
Felix Mourinho is a nervous dad when his son's games are on television, so much so that he leaves the house while the match is being played and waits for his wife to ring him with score updates.
Eu vivo essas vitórias intensamente, talvez até mais intensamente do que vivia as minhas no tempo em que jogava.
You weren't a goalkeeper, were you?
No, I when I was a kid, I think I, like every kid, I want to score goals, you know, and I was feeling good enough to play, but not good enough to succeed or to achieve a good a good level.
I remember he was player in Belenenses in Vitória Setúbal. Ooh, good technique, not so fast, but good skills. But I think always also studying and make investment as a student and to see the future.
Your father became a coach, yeah. And you played for him. Was that difficult?
No, I was with him just one season.
Yeah.
Was the season where, at that period in Portugal, you could never go direct from high school to university. There was always 1 year mm-hmm. where people has to be waiting for
a
university.
A year out.
Yes, a year out. You know. So at that time, I was playing with my father team, and
there was a bit of controversy there, wasn't it, about whether he should pick you in the team or not? And
I think is a situation depends of culture, you know, depends of culture. I have to say that this season when I saw Jamie Redknapp to play to his father, I was in love with that team because it was a feeling I could never had, the son helping his father. Was bad for me. Was bad for me, not bad for my father, was bad for me, because...
In what sense?
In the sense where I should play more. And I didn't, because his options were always against the controversy. Mm. And I was the first at that time, I remember a few times, to tell him, I know I deserve, but forget it. Forget it, go the other way,
it's
I'm with
awkward.
You, and we go to the easy way for us.
You said yourself that you realised relatively early that you were not going to reach the very top mm-hmm. level. Was that difficult for someone
no,
with your personality
no,
to
no,
deal
no,
with?
No, was not difficult, you know, was not difficult. At that time I was already in love with my wife, you know, and waiting a few more years to just to marry and to have my wife, my life organized. And at that time things went into a comfortable direction, you know. I was a school teacher in the morning. So I had my stability. In the afternoon, I was coaching my city team, Vitória Setúbal, in sub-18.
In his early 20s, Jose realised he would never achieve great success as a professional footballer. As a student, he took the first steps into management.
I remember that me and then some friends went to some games, and sometimes we tried to joke with him, you know, Jose, do that. He never hurts, you know, never. Was only that you don't hear, only the game. That's when I understood that the guy, you know, is completely focused. At that time, there's no world. There's only football, you know.
Jose went to university in Lisbon and took an academic approach to his study of the game.
José Mourinho was a very good student because he loves football. So in that time, he always showed that he wants to know many things. He starts the motivation and the interest that he shows all the time.
He's a product of study. He's read and he's worked and he's learned, and he said it's taken me 15 years to become an overnight success.
Do you think it's any coincidence that, say, for example, the top three coaches in this country at the moment, yourself, Alex Ferguson, Arsene Wenger, none of the three of you were particularly great players. I think Alex might possibly disagree with that, but none of you played at the very top level. Do you think that perhaps helps in some way?
I had time to prepare my career that a professional player didn't have. So if you jump direct from I was a great player to try to be a manager, I think you are not ready for.
Difficult.
You know, it's difficult. The same way you can study all your life, but if you don't have a strong connection with the world of football, you are not ready, because you go into that world and you can know a lot about all the science connected with football. You don't understand the game, you have no chance.
Football may be a universal language, but Bobby Robson needed a translator when he moved to Sporting Lisbon. It would be Jose Mourinho's first job in the professional game and the beginning of a successful partnership which lasted 5 years.
When Bobby Robson stepped off the plane from London to become a coach at Sporting Lisbon, the little guy who greeted him said, "Hello, I'm Jose Mourinho."
Is possible?
He was initially employed as an interpreter. That's how he started working with players, really, and sort of got a grounding in the game.
He had an air of confidence about him. I think he was a bit nervous about meeting me. I mean, I detected that.
Is it true that you were Bobby's interpreter?
No, the true is that I was his interpreter. I was his scout. I saw players. I saw teams. I was goalkeeper coach because we didn't have at that time. I help in training sessions. I think I was everything. I gave him everything. Everything I had, I gave. So I think as a very nice person, he recognized my contribution to him.
Hey, Jamie. I couldn't have handled it really without him, in terms of speaking to the players, having a liaison with the players, having a liaison with the president. Never fell out with anybody, always respectful. Epitomised what I said to the players and how I felt about the game and the way the team played and what happened, what didn't happen. And he could transmit that very fluently and respectfully. He was super. I'm not going to go to Barcelona, am I? Ill-prepared, unless I know taking Jose is going to be an advantage to me and to Barcelona, and of course for himself it was wonderful.
Many years with Bobby, what did you learn most from him?
I learned a lot of things, you know, but the first thing I get from a person is the human being he is, you know, and I think it's difficult to find in football such a beautiful person like he is, and the way, of course, we are different, and I don't want to try to be copies of anybody, because copies are always worse than the original. But he was good in training, he was very enthusiastic. You know, Sir Bobby loves the pitch. He loves the pitch. So as an assistant, you work in other areas to support that, but not so much that direct relation with the coaching session.
Because Bobby always liked to take sessions.
Very studious, asked questions all the time, saw the players train, saw how we trained, saw what we did in training, learned, listened, looked, remembered, did all of those things. Look where he is now. Absolutely fantastic.
He brought me from a low level to the highest level you can imagine. So as Bobby assistant, I went from Sporting, Porto and Barcelona. And when I left Barcelona, I was ready to start my career.
That was your first period of a lot of success, because yes. A lot of trophies in both Portugal, yes. And of course Spain.
Yes, with Bobby was fantastic. We won everything in the Portuguese competitions, two leagues and one cup, two super cups. We went to Barca. In Bobby's period, we were not champions, but we won Cup Winners' Cup and Spanish Cup, Spanish Super Cup.
After Bobby Robson was at Barcelona for 1 year, he moved upstairs. Now, normally in those circumstances, his staff can perhaps be moved away and moved outside, but you stay with Van Gaal. Was that a surprise? Or
The personalities are different, but I have to say that Van Gaal is also a beautiful person. You know? He's somebody with, I don't say two faces, a little bit like me. I think he's a little bit like me, you know.
In what sense?
In the sense where only people who knows him well knows who he is. Mm. Luis loves to analyze and gives you the complete control of the training session. So you become with him a coach on the pitch. So you coach players. So when I was 30, 32, something like 34, I don't remember that, but very, very young to be a manager, you have on your hands Rivaldo, Ronaldo, Figo, Stoichkov, and coach them.
Tough to teach them.
It was fantastic experience. And with them, I got something that still is very important in my methodology, is communication. Is to get feedbacks also from them, from the players. And Luis, I think I created with him a very, very strong relation. And it was very important also to give me confidence, you know. I always remember with him.
Have you ever lacked confidence?
No, but he told me things very important for my career. I never forget this. Benfica president called me and he say to me, you are in Barcelona. I want you in Benfica to assist you Paincas. I told to Luis, happened this. I received this phone call and I have this big chance to go home and to have a good situation for me. He told me, pick up the telephone and tell Benfica president, if he wants you to assist you Paincas, no. If he wants you to be the manager, I take you to the airport and you go. Mm. Because you are ready for that. No more assistant. When you leave me, is to be top manager. So I have a few memories of my relation with Luis, and it was very important for me.
When a call came from the biggest club in Portugal, Mourinho had to take it. Benfica were looking for a new boss, and Jose was ready to take the step up as manager. When he eventually left Portugal, he'd won every title going, including the Champions League.
When I left Barcelona, I was completely focused on being
a number one.
Being a number one, you know.
Your first job was as a number one was Benfica,
yeah.
And that went a bit sour quite quickly, didn't it?
Oh, it was amazing because when I went to Benfica, was a period of election coming in 3 months' time.
For the president?
For the president, yeah.
Well, I met Jose Mourinho in Barcelona by chance, and I spoke with him. It was enough 5 minutes. After talking with him in 5 minutes, I said, well, this is a completely different man. This is a unique personality. And I said, well, he's the right man.
I went in October and elections in December. And the president couldn't give me a long-term contract because of that. He was saying it was not ethic. He can lose elections and the new president comes. And I gave you a 5-year contract. I cannot do that. So you have to accept the short-term contract.
It was a big risk at the time because Benfica was in a sort of a process of elections. And even all my board resigned. But it was really difficult. The press was completely against and said a lot of silly things. Said that Mourinho was only a translator.
He lost the elections. a new president arrive. So when he lost the elections, I knew at that time I have no chances because he has his own man. So I was succeeding. The results were very good. We just finished to beat Sporting in the derby. We beat them 3-0. And at that time I told the president, it's time for you to make a choice. Or with this kind of results, you give me the new contract and I can know I'm working for the future of the club. Or if you still stick with your first choice, I have to go. So people at that time couldn't believe such a young manager was leaving Benfica.
Yeah.
You know, because I left Benfica, you know.
And you went to a small club called
Leiria. Yeah.
And maybe the first signs of the special one. You took them to the UEFA Cup, which was quite an achievement.
We took him to the third place. It was a very small club. At that time was not easy for me. For the first time, I left my wife and kids in Lisbon, not with me, because it was not a good place to take them with me. I just there focused in, I have to succeed, and I have to go back quick to my previous level. So I went there with my staff, just thinking about that. And I went to Brazil to find players with peanuts and bananas, you know, no money. So I got players for 100,000 euros on loan, this kind of situation. And we did fantastic. So we were third in the table. In the end of the day, I had Benfica and Porto fighting for me. Mm. The president that doesn't want to give me the long-term contract was fighting for me.
The same guy.
He's fantastic football. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but you went to Porto, mm-hmm. and when you took them over, they were struggling.
Leiria was third and they were fifth.
Yeah.
And for Porto to be fifth and struggling to get a UEFA position was incredible. But we won everything in the first year. In Portugal, is simple. You have a very good team, you win the championship. No doubts.
Eu tenho certeza que no próximo ano.
So it's easy for me in Portugal to say, as I told in Porto, beginning of season, we will be champions. No risk. Second year was even better because we repeat the Portuguese trophies. We just lost the Portuguese Cup final. We lost in extra time. And we won Champions League.
Probably he will regret for the rest of his life that he didn't celebrate with Porto the victory in Gelsenkirchen. He didn't, you know. He stepped away from the field, and here in Porto he didn't even come out from the airport. But the important is that he achieved great things in Porto. He's a great coach, and I'm absolutely sure that no Porto supporter would think twice if he had the possibility of return.
We did it almost without money, because I took to Porto four Leiria players, so my peanuts players, we sold them to Porto. So we built a great team with Porto, and just with quality and confidence and working hard to improve the team.
And that's and it, step that's by step was and fantastic. That's it, is it? That's all there is to it. The yeah. Confidence, working hard.
Yes, and quality. No quality, no chance.
And you have to believe you can score. My life is about keeping one step ahead.
He's one of the first managers I can think of that has really made it into the feature pages of newspapers. You know, we're used to seeing obviously the David Beckhams and the Jamie Redknapps, the handsome players. But, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but I've never seen a fashion item about Sir Alex Ferguson. Jose Mourinho has made that transition.
Mourinho's up there with Beckham, with Zidane, with Raul. You know, he's as big a star as many of the world's great players. Certainly at Chelsea, I mean, he is probably the biggest star they have. The biggest box office. He's probably the highest paid member of that staff now. He's a phenomenon, but he's a winner.
The looks factor is sort of almost the factor that dare not speak its name. It's sort of considered rather crass to think that because somebody looks stunning that they have a special quality.
He has that sort of permanent sort of 5 o'clock shadow. He's got very sexy eyes. He's got a very sexy manner about him.
He clearly fancies himself. Clearly, every woman I know fancies him, which is even more depressing.
And he's totally gorgeous.
So I'm not content with just being a football manager, a fashion icon, some sort of sex god. We then see Jose trotting over to Israel to cure the world of the Middle East peace problem.
Jose Mourinho is here as a guest of Shimon Peres, Israel's deputy prime minister.
I think football is powerful in social terms, and a football man becomes powerful in social terms. I accepted that invitation to go to Middle East because I'm not a political man, but I know that was for children, and children with a lot of problems as consequence of war. So I always will be ready for that. You must use the power football gives you. You must use in good situations for the world.
It hasn't all been good news for Jose Mourinho. The criticism of the referee in Barcelona and the alleged tapping up of Arsenal's Ashley Cole have resulted in critical newspaper headlines.
He's got an extraordinary appetite for confrontation. That is one thing I've never seen before. People have compared him with Brian Clough, but even Brian Clough, you know, didn't want to fight everybody all the time, particularly in Barcelona with the business of Anders Frisk, the referee whose honour he unfairly impugned. I wish Mourinho had apologised for that.
Are you a bad loser?
Yes, I'm a bad loser. Yeah.
Was it hard to cope when you didn't quite make it against Liverpool in Champions League? I mean, you've won pretty much every trophy you've entered for the last 3 or 4 years.
Yes, was easy when, I don't know, the goal was not a goal. Was easy. I got it with respect for them, for Liverpool. I shake every hand. I wish luck to all of them. I got it as a football man who understand that you cannot win every time and you have to lose. When I saw television, I couldn't believe. And was hard to live with it. And especially hard to live with it and close the mouth. For me, it's very hard to close the mouth. When I'm not happy, it's very, very hard.
You've come a long way since the days that you were in Barcelona, and as the famous quote, "Who's the good-looking kid with a granddad?" when you were with Bobby Robson. You must be very proud of what you've achieved. Have you surprised yourself?
It was too soon, too quick. I was never thinking could be too quick. You know, I was completely sure of my success in the Portuguese football. I know I could make the difference. I know the reality. I know the players. I know the teams. I know the managers. So I was preparing myself, and I know when I go there, quick. But I was thinking of Portuguese champion, Portuguese Cup, being the best club, but with a cup, Champions League, Chelsea, yeah. was too quick. Was too quick. But I think I was mentally ready for that.
And what's next? You signed agreed a long-term contract
5
with Chelsea. The ambition now, world domination, is it?
Yes, is win and repeat and repeat.
Is football the most important thing in your life?
No. As you.
And family?
As every father, I think.
Just thought I'd check.
Yes, it's fantastic, you know?
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
And we've not seen the last of the special one. There's more to come.
I'm not a special one. I was under pressure. You put me under pressure when I arrived. I arrived here, you know, European champion, you know. I arrive here one week later, so I think the European champion is arriving. You don't respect me. You put me 50 difficult questions, and can you succeed, and are you ready for this, and are you ready for that? And I was thinking, what is this? I'm the special one. And you never forget it, what I told you.